So I'm going to start off with this quote. I think I've recently become obsessed with Karen Barad, actually thanks to a good friend of mine who happens to be in the room right now. names withheld. So Karen Barad is a professor in feminist studies and philosophy and history of consciousness at UC Santa Cruz. And without getting into like her whole system of thinking, she's dealing mostly with material feminism and has a PhD in quantum physics. So she brings a very techno-scientific take on the possibilities of feminism. So this quote, when is a broken off limb just a part of the environment and when is it offspring? I want to talk about it out of context from what she gave a lecture in which she used this, proposed this question. I think about, okay, what is this limb? And the first things that come to mind is like a tree limb or like my arm. And when I think of the tree losing its limb, I think, okay, I get the offspring. It's the limb lands on the on the ground, and Jesus, you guys, the limb lands on the ground and sprouts a seedling, and by all standards, we call that offspring. If I lose my limb and it's there laying on the floor next to me. Aside from the sort of shock and horror of it all, there's likely a sort of repulsion or rejection that occurs to this discarded part of myself. And certainly, if I called it offspring, most people would send me to the psych ward. But I think what I like to think about is how, when that limb falls on into the earth, it decomposes and it generates life for a million billion little organisms. And so it leads to the question of what do we consider to be generative of growth or to be offspring, or where do we define difference and where do we set terms of what is and what isn't? And that's kind of maybe something that I ponder in a lot of ways, in different ways that I work. So we'll see if that makes sense in the end. So I'm going to go over, I'm going to kind of jump around. I can't believe how hot it is in here, you guys. I'm going to jump around a little bit. I'm going to show like some work from a show that's about a year old. It happened to a solo show from a year ago. I'm going to go then back in time to some collaborative work to give you some groundwork for some of the larger projects that were mentioned in the bio. And then I'll come back to where I am at this very second, and we'll try and keep that into an hour-ish. I've been thinking about flowers a lot recently, partially because they're intersexed, interspecies procreators, and I think they're I think of them kind of like cyborgs, I guess. But that's not the reason I made this piece that I'm going to show you. That's just kind of one angle I come at flowers from. The other angle I come at it from is that they tend to be constructs of cliches and ideals around gender and beauty. And so I ended up at the Orchid Show in the Botanical Gardens in the New York Botanical Gardens in the Bronx. With my mother. I was, sort of repulsed and fascinated by this sort of collective behavior that's typical of any situation in which people are collecting to look, which is that people were not looking, but they were taking photos. So for me, I kind of got interested in, this sort of compulsive ritual that we're all engaged in, but also how I think typically photos and the spectacle, there's a kind of scale that we tend to relate to the compulsion of image making that we live in today. that is the spectacle as some kind of, you know, there's the protest or there's the event or there's like Beyonce or I don't know what, you know, something, some spectacle. and the flower and in this environment, in this highly procured natural setting, was sort of fascinating to me in terms of humans' relationship to nature. And so I'm only gonna show you real video clips in the very end of this, just because this would take so much longer if you watch video clips. So this work, if you're interested in watching it, is up on my website. You can watch the whole thing, so you don't have to watch it now. And part of the way I worked on this was I went and I just shot, I became like a kind of creepy lurking, you know, my camera joined all the other cameras essentially. And the way it's shot is kind of, the camera moves and a lot, and I ended up actually reshooting after I sort of edited, did a quick edit of the video, I reshot the screen. And so there's moments when this sort of inset screen appears. And for me, there was sort of some cycle of like looking and looking again that I wanted to be engaged with when I started that technique. And it's also, the whole thing is set to a track, a classical music track that I am going to forget the name of. Did I put it in my notes? That's what they're here for. Ruth Crawford Seeger, Kaleidoscopic Changes on Original Theme Ending with a Fugue. And so I was looking for women who were classical composers, which at least in the turn of the last century was harder to find. And so I set this sort of what I would call a rather boring video to that soundtrack. And it was actually intentionally boring. I was really interested in the kind of repetition and monotony of this kind of activity. So I was kind of thinking about flowers and making this document of the sort of experience at the botanical gardens. And within sort of 6 months of that, starting to work on that, I started to work in a foundry because I was teaching down at VCU and they happened to have a foundry on campus. And I'd never had the experience of working with hot metal. So I learned the process while I was down there. And this is something I kind of want to talk about in general, which is like how process and how experience and how your own set of desires and interests like become work, which is I sort of more and more have been letting go of like why am I making this work than what is motivating my work. And there's always a reason why at the end, but I start with the sort of motivation and a series of interests to move me in and through work. And I ask questions as I go. So the first thing for me was just learning a new material process, and the second thing was sort of realizing, thinking a lot about the physicality of the body in terms of labor and production of artworks, but also the fact that the foundry also is, of course, a site of, historically a site of blue-collar labor and a kind of manufacturing, an industry that's sort of dwindling, as we know. And so in that, I sort of, some of it was like very personal in terms of like you come home from working in the foundry and you're like I'm wearing what I usually wear, which is a pair of jeans and a button-down shirt, and you're dirty and you just want to discard this garment. And so I started this series of monoprint relief works that are made out of aluminum. And I see them as sort of as absent of the body, and they're sort of haunted in that way. And that's, for me, kind of a reflection on their own making, I guess, and on the representation that this kind of, that the clothing or the garment that one works in represents. So they started out as these sort of discarded gestures. And then I started folding them. And this had to do with having to work at a different foundry and working with different types of sand and stuff. There's a whole kind of material process that I had to shift around in. And I sort of got interested in the sort of geometric abstraction or possibilities. And then I've worked towards the shirt that's under the the undershirt and the outer shirt. Yeah. So while I was in the foundry, I spent a lot of time around a lot of sand, because the way that these aluminum molds are made is, if you see that pink material that they're pouring the metal into, that is a sand with a resin mix in it. Sand being a glass-based element, right? Holds up to the heat of the metal in the mold-making process. And so I started thinking a lot about like the possibilities of sand to hold form, especially when sand is something that sort of rejects holding form for the most part. And it's also a kind of thing that when I went up to work at a foundry while I was doing this, some of this for the show, and it was summertime. And sort of right after that, I went to the beach, as one does in the summer. And again, this is sort of what I mean, where I'm like, I like to go along in life, and I'm like, oh, sand. Well, there's something about sand. And it became interesting to me. It's like when you're in sand, it's like very few things grow in sand. Sand sort of absorbs things. It becomes sort of full of garbage in places that are highly populated with sand. And then this sort of notion of being able to form it. So I ended up making these like monoliths, just because I'm nuts, I think, actually, at the end of the day. But those are 500-pound sand walls. And these became a kind of composite of the things that I had been experiencing or that I was interested in while I was putting the show together. So one thing was that I was sort of making these metal works, these metal shirts and stuff. And then I had, been wandering around the botanical garden, stalking people with cameras. And so there was a few different things that I was thinking about. One is I had started to look at Mapplethorpe's flower series, partially because I felt like it was like this really canonical moment in art where I remember it in the 90s. It was that moment where it's something that went like straight to your calendar. It was like art that went straight to a calendar. And there's something about I was interested in that as a kind of the kind of flower entering this sort of mass production and its relationship to art, and this kind of, there's a lot of things that were happening in that space of Mapplethorpe's images for me that seemed really generative. I also there's a quote from Mapplethorpe that's, photographing a flower is not much different than photographing a cock. Basically, it's the same thing. It's about lighting and composition. So I also think about how he created these really sort of utterly objectified, he had a real interest in absolute objectification. And the way that that kind of has a relationship to commerce and market is, I think, I don't know, pointed. Anyways, so I was thinking about what is natural and what is not natural in many ways, and made these resin It's sand with resin, and there's also, that's like, there's like spirulina and some other things, some supplements in there. And then there's also some running shoe bottoms, because of course, what else would you put in a sand wall? But the molds of the running shoes, you know, also came from, like, I was out on the beach and was actually went on a run on the beach, like, you know, as one does. And here's with the flower images embedded in with the shoes and the everything that's kind of caked in there. And I started, so these are kind of, for me, actually almost like an engorged sketches for some, a bunch of ideas that I like, I sort of piled into these objects. And there's, in many ways, I would say that this is the beginning of something I want to work on in various ways, and it's materially something I'm really interested in, but is this its greatest manifestation? I question, I don't know, but the interest in the running shoes came out of thinking about running shoes as a kind of extension of what I'm thinking about with the flowers in terms of almost like being a cyborg or being the way that things are designed to make your body exceed its limits. And I think of supplements functioning the same way. And yeah, that's what I'm gonna say about that right now. I'm gonna keep going. You can ask me questions about it later. I'm sure there's something I missed, but. Okay, so fertility, this piece is called Fertility Bowl. There's a whole series of these. I'm gonna show a few of them. These works are made on, actually it's the kind of material that you use to block out light in a dark room, but what it is it's kind of vinyl coated on one side. It's like with a white kind of vinyl-y material on one side, and it's a kind of canvas material on the other. Raw canvas. So the white material on the reverse side, which you can hardly see, like, I don't know, like that edge there, feels like the wall peeling off of itself a little bit. And the way the work is hung up is by jamming a penny into the surface of the drywall, which you can see. This is two views of the same piece, obviously, but the reason I've given you two views is because the way they hang in a gallery or whatever is like this, but you're allowed to touch them. So you might peel it open and see it in more detail or look around it. It's actually entertaining. Sometimes people think they can't touch them, and there's a lot of this going on when people try to look at them. and touching them for me is like just, I don't know, I have a hard time with like the, I've been had arguments with my gallerist about like they should be put in a box, and then they are, you know, and all this stuff, and I'm like, but so they get ruined. They've been ruined. They continue to get ruined, and I'm working with that. They're small. They're like a kind of like a sheet of paper size. Anyway, so they're collages that are essentially iron-ons on the fabric material, and the collages are composed on the fabric, not like somehow prior and then, you know, I'm kind of cutting up all the parts and ironing each layer on. It's like a much more arduous than it should be or needs to be, but that's how I work. So what happened is this is for a different show, but I was thinking a lot about sort of really basic ideas around sculpture and around making and around again, labor. You'll see that a lot of these things kind of show up over and over again for me. And so I went to the New York Public Library, and I went, they have, you know, the image archive there, which if you haven't been, you should go, because it's really better than Google. but it's similar principle in the sense that you can like look up a word and you get a litany of images that you may or may not find associated with that word, or that might lead you to other things that you might be thinking about. So it's a really great stream of consciousness kind of visual space to go to. So I started collecting images through there, and I was looking up things like, primarily first I looked up sculpture, and then, you know, clay, and then how to make sculpture, like diagrammatic imagery, pottery, some various forms. And then that started to lead me, when I was in the sculpture files, that led me to some fertility sculptures as like, you know, discussions of origins of sculpture and such, and archaeological digs. And then that also kind of led me to furniture, architecture, and monuments. And sort of that train of thought was going along with issues around labor, like physical labor, labor as in birth, and labor as in sort of labor movements and such. So like this piece, Fertility Bowl, is an excerpt from the Post. There's a quote in there that basically says, Occupy Wall Street with strollers. And so this is also made like on the heels of Occupy and the Post. This is something from the Post. So that there's a woman in front of the bowl in Wall Street with her children, and it's all about how people are moving into Wall Street, and then I've sort of inserted this fertility sculpture. So these works I really function for me in a stream of consciousness kind of way. Like I went in and I dug into the archive in that way, and I followed certain trains of thought, and then I assembled them very like freeform. So the logic behind them is for the most part very spontaneous in their generation. That's what the penny looks like, holding it into the wall. This one's called In Labor, and that's the piece at the top is from, that black area is from an illustration from a 1930s brochure. It was a labor union brochure. And I thought it was interesting because the language that was used was similar to things that were coming up at Occupy. And then, of course, there's another protest march, and that's from the 60s. And you'll notice that the signs don't look that different than things that were happening now, or that people. So there's also, for me, an interest. So this was in the space, of course, with that fertility bowl. So it's like there's this movement through time in terms of contemporary and historical relationships. This is Window in My Way. That is an architectural space with some kind of lava that's grown through it or something. Hold Mold Monument. There's some pottery making and monuments. This one's called Figuratively, and that's like a how to make a figurative sculpture on the outside, sandwiching an image of a woman turned into a chair, which was a whole other category I ended up in, which is when I got to furniture, for some reason, there is a litany of ways that people have turned women into furniture, which was a real, I don't know, that's a whole other, anyways. there's one more.
A real person, a woman?
Suppose, you know, I'm getting, you know, I'm calling an archive, so it's something that was a clipping from 85 or something. You know, I don't have the whole story of the image, so, but I, yeah. Anyways, so speaking of that, women, sexuality, gender, and being not being furniture. So I'm going back in time. This is 2010. Was the release of Community Action Center, and so this is a major collaborative work, and I'm going to try to go over it very quickly. It's a very long, very big project that I could give an entire hour and a half lecture about. And if anyone really wants to see the work, it is in the archives at the MoMA. And if you don't know, you can go to the MoMA, their library and their film archives, and you can request to see films and videos and other materials from the from their archive, which is, there's just so many amazing things there. But yeah, it is out there and it is available to you if you want to go see it. So Community Action Center is was set, okay, is a project I started with A.L. Steiner, So it's collaborative. And then it worked with an upward of around 50 performers, musicians, various creative people, extended community who were willing and able to kind of dive into this project with us. So this is a project that, you know, I can say that I authored in some way, but it's also something that was definitively not possible without the energy and creative efforts of a lot of people. So this is a poster for it in a kind of exploded light box situation that was in one of the installations for the show. This is a curtain, a pleather curtain, that was for the entryway of some of the installations because this is like a dumb joke about walking through a vagina to get to the video screening. So is this one. So we had two versions of the ruffled curtains to go through. This version was actually the drop cloth that was used to make this scene, which is the opening scene of the video, which we called the art orgy, which took place in Nicole Eisenman's studio. And without getting into every detail of what goes on in all the scenes, because I think that's too much for right now, generally what we set out to do was rethink what the possibilities of a pornographic film could be. And in that, we were really concerned with the representation of women, queer, and trans bodies in that realm. And also with, even within the burgeoning trans and queer cinema realm in terms of pornographic content, we felt like there was a lot that followed, let's say, heteronormative tropes, in the sense that maybe the butch is the top, or there's a bedroom scene, or like there's like these things that happen in porn that we thought, you know, this could be a lot more interesting. It could be a lot more weird. Sex is really weird. Like, you know, let's try. Let's see what we come up with. So, and one of the premises for us was that the entire body is a sex organ, and in that sense, that required you. What would so a big question is what constitutes sex, and this idea of being sort of limited to ideas of intercourse or those kind of things got thrown out the window right away. There are some explicit scenes of that nature in this film, but the bulk of the film has very little to do with typical forms of intercourse, and so. That the other premise we had was that if the whole body is a sex organ, then also that they required a kind of sense that you approach sex as a creative act, in a sense. And so one of the things that we did is, like, if there were anything that was going to interact with the body, much like a sex toy would, let's say, it had to be found or created. So there was nothing. You were not going to purchase or engage in sort of forms of economy that were already predetermined around sexuality. And so that also required us, putting some of those rules down actually required us to be consistently creative or sort of constantly looking at the play between form and content. And there's what else do I want to say? I think that's, I feel like I'm going to end up asking a lot of questions about this later, but I'm just going to, these are all video stills. So this is just to give you a sort of sensibility about the work, because I can't really, it's also all set to, it's a series of vignettes. It's all set to music. There's no audio. I mean, no dialogue in it. because we were like, you know, who needs dialogue in a, you know, you just, it's pleasure and repulsion, that's all we need. So we're just, and in that way that we were also like examining what is the spectrum of desire, right? So that does mean for us looking at going from pleasure to repulsion, which is, I know this scene, I heard the E, which is a typical response to this scene, which is the threading scene. So you're not alone. A lot of people feel that way. there is a scene with Eileen Miles up there, and Eileen does recite some poetry. That's the only spoken part in the whole film. There's a lot of food and fruit and vegetables and cats and I don't know. There's a pizza boy and a witch. You know, it's really, it was kind of everything you need to make, you know. So what I'm more interested in maybe talking about than getting into the entire, it's for me so much to get into all of the politics that Community Action Center touches on, and is kind of the way that we dealt with it is what I would like to call is like a holistic project. So one of the things we did, we made the poster. We had cheap posters that you could take. We had the Community Action Center Cliff Notes, which was a zine that where we kind of packed in all kinds of resources and images and things that were generative to our producing the work. And you know, we started with even just like looking at what the word pornography means, which engages with, where is it? I thought there was a thing about property, place of meaning. Okay, anyways, I'm not gonna get into that. You can also download this off my website. You can have the PDF of this, so it's out there if you wanna read it. And so this is another thing. I'm a real fan of digging into archives if you haven't caught that already. And so there's some images from On Our Back magazine, which is a dyke magazine from the 90s. Because we're thinking a lot about what produces certain types of aesthetics or genres. And then we also had excerpts from texts that were generative for us. This is Normal Love by Jack Smith. And there's a recitation of Normal Love by Justin Vivian Bond at the beginning, at the orgy, art orgy scene in the film. I sort of throw this in here because this is like my own, to get us to the point of the thing that I really want to talk about, which is distribution of the work. Except this is kind of a weird way to do it. I'm gonna go to this one first and then I'll go back to that one. Basically what happens when you work with all of your friends to make a porn is you're lucky if they don't freak out. And then being women and queers and trans bodies, everyone is also very deeply in dialogue with what it means to use and or exploit one's body in any circumstances, and in particular within pornography, the question becomes very fraught. And so there was a really, the first major thing that had to happen was, what does it mean to distribute this work? We were definitely not gonna put it on the internet. That's the quickest way for everyone to be able to see it. But we wanted to actually be very counter kind of contemporary distribution methods in an effort to take care of what it meant for this work to be seen. So that also meant that we were sort of, the way that porn is typically consumed now, of course, comes off of most people's personal computers. And we also wanted to be sort of counter of that kind of, what had occurred in that was a kind of privatization of, and what I would even extend to a kind of shaming of sexuality in terms of, there are not really public spaces for shared, or there are, but they are, continue to be more and more limited for sharing those kind of experiences or I don't know, I guess we wanted to challenge the sort of notion of being isolated in that experience, and that there's something to benefit from in terms of bringing people together in that space. And that was for us also hearkening back to looking at, like, in particular, porn theaters and other spaces that provide that kind of public space for, but also that those spaces have very rarely ever been occupied by women in particular. They tend to cater to, obviously, a certain demographic. So, what was I going to, okay. So, in terms of distribution, we were not going to put it on the internet, so we also decided that it could not be owned by an individual or a private collector. So we didn't want, we sort of wanted to extend the premise of what was in the title, Community Action Center, and the fact that it was built on and for and by a community of people, and that it, that the work has to always be seen in a group setting. So you can't actually watch it alone, is one of the rules. So if you go to the MoMA, please bring someone with you. I can't enforce it there, but I say, please bring someone with you. It's a better experience with someone else, I swear. So part of that is having it in archives, having it in public spaces. It's, you know, been purchased by various educational institutions at this point, and it lives in a few archives across the country. But it also meant that that's kind of a very specialized set of people that have access to or even know about, you know, going to the MoMA. Like, this is like an art thing. It really isolates the work to a very particular kind of audience. And so then our next problem was, how do we get it to everyone who's not in the art world, but for whom we feel like it might be important to share the work with? So we did a fundraiser, and we took the it on two tours, one in Europe and one in the States. And this is how many places we were able to get to. And so our goal was basically small town USA. And that is a whole other set of stories in terms of the, like, incredible experiences we had traveling and meeting people and sharing the work that way. But I mostly wanted to bring this up because I think that Community Action Center is sort of like, yeah, there was the film that was made. There's all the people that put all their kind of energy into making it possible to have it. And then there was this sort of like way that it had to be carried into the world that was an extension of what the entire premise of that work was. And I, you know, I don't think all work has to be dealt with such diligence, but I do think it's a way that I've been thinking about some larger projects that I do, and I think is a kind of important, can be a really important factor in the making and meaning of something. And I don't know, you know, I put this in because this is the biggest poster I've ever seen. They printed that in Europe, and then they tried to put it in the U-Bahn, like the Kampnagel, which is the place that we were screening this at, gave it to the U-Bahn and was like, hey, can you put these posters up in the subway? Like, only in Europe would somebody do that. Okay, and so, and then of course there was this, and we didn't know this, we got to Europe and found out this was happening and that this news had already hit. So this is like, this is the most salacious thing that happened on all of our touring, really, which was that the U-Bahn rejected the posters and would not post them because they thought they were scatological. Although that is a chocolate donut that is spread over the body. Anyways, that's a whole, it's just, I'm just telling you that story because it's funny. Okay, we'll move on. Okay, so this is a project called The Brown Bear, neither particular nor general. It was at Recess in 2010. I don't know if you guys know Recess, but it's a really great nonprofit residency program. It's in Soho. This is a project I did with my partner, Catherine Hubbard, and it generated out of a lot of
kind of crossover discussions, things that are, you know, in our world. This came out of first finding this text by Gertrude Stein, Mrs. Fur and Mrs. Skeen. We were, a friend had given us this book, and we like were, you know, flipping through it, and then we read this, and it was, anyways, and we had this whole moment where this is a text that's written in 1912, I believe. And Gertrude Stein tells a story of Mrs. Fur and Mrs. Skeen, and their relationship, which is built on cultivating basically, they talk about, well, okay, sorry, cultivating something. The something is never really given. And that they are being gay in every way, every day. So in classic Stein alliteration, the word gay is used like hundreds times over the course of about 4 or 5 pages. And what happens is the word, which in its period meant happiness or various forms of frivolity, becomes the word that it means now in describing the relationship of these two women. And their, and so we were like, oh, this is crazy. This is like the text almost where this word changes, you know? So that's one thing is going on. We discovered that. And then this other thing is happening, which is that Katie's cousin comes to town. She's just come out of the closet. She's like 21, and she's like, I want to visit some lesbians and see what it's like. So she comes to our house. And this is something you start to realize when you, I mean, I sort of remember that moment where you're like, oh, okay, what does this thing look like? Like, you know, I can't look at my, you know, if you don't already have a peer group, some people are lucky enough to find those peer groups when they're young, but I certainly didn't. and I also, you know, I'm not that old, but pop culture hadn't really, you know, cultivated an image for us yet. But I was also, so it was interesting to have someone come and be like, oh, look, I can come see what this looks like. And in that process, she came with her long hair, and then she saw me, and she'd be like, I really like your hair. I like your, and everything was like, you could see her like eyeing up this vision, future vision, you know? And so before she'd left, we ended up cutting her hair and like going through this whole process, and that sort of became this really symbolic ritual, something that we already cut each other's hair, and there's a lot of hair cutting happening in our world anyways, but this sort of production of self through aesthetics and how that is developed started to be like a really big idea for us through that kind of that specific haircut. And the other thing that happened during that haircut is we said, oh, hey, can you go get us a picture of what you're thinking about? She came back with the internet with a picture of Shane from the L Word, and it was also that moment when we started to realize like, oh yeah, this is generationally something very specific where we do now have a pop cultural image. And so what does it mean when you don't have an image and how that image forms, and then what does it mean once there is an image and how that forms? And so that became the premise for The Brown Bear, which was in honor of Gertrude Stein, was a art salon as well as a hair salon. And so one thing we did is we traveled across the US. Well, we were on a road trip for other reasons, but you know, along the way we stopped at LGBT archives. And again, you can see I'm obsessed with archive. And we basically started looking for images that that had to do with hair, that had to do with presentation, that had to do with fashion and style. So we were going through the LGBT archives and actually trying to find the images for ourselves that where our even tropes of homosexuality had emerged, for that matter, you know? And so what you see are here is basically this is, the space is fairly long at recess. We built a diagonal wall that met, so there's a wall on the right and this wall comes from the wall on the left and comes and meets the wall on the right. So it's a very long diagonal wall we built. There's a wedge that you can see at the far end, which was mirrored and had a Xerox machine sort of sitting in the wedge. And then all along the sides are shelves that are slotted. Well, hold on. Here, we're fast approaching the Xerox machine. And this is a bad pun. This is the duplication station being repeated. Okay. Come on, you guys. This is, this is a close-up of one of the shelves, and the shelves had like three slots in them. So you could pick up the materials and replace them anywhere you wanted to. And the whole idea was that it was sort of like an, again, like an exploded zine or something. It was like this, and you could go to the Xerox machine and take anything with you. It was really important to us that whatever we were presenting from the archives felt like something we didn't possess, or that it was generative of people continuing the process of looking and collecting. So that's, you can kind of see how the shelves were stacked with materials. And a lot of those are like photographs of things that we found in the archives, and then some of them are Xeroxes. And then as the project progressed and people were doing events, because we had the salons, there would be material residue from the salons and those would end up on the shelves. And so it kind of grew over time. And then we also gave haircuts. And you didn't have a mirror, you were not allowed to bring us an image, and you had to negotiate with the two of us who were going to cut your hair in tandem, just to make it a little crazier, to get your hair cut. The haircut is free, and all we wanted was the discussion. We were curious, people would come in and want something radical done to their heads. Some people were like, I have to be able to go to work tomorrow. And so just in that dialogue, a lot would come up, obviously, about how people limit and or generate their own sense of self and image.
Did you cut Corey's hair?
Corey? You know what? He did not sit in the chair. He just came and swung by.
Cameo in the back.
Yeah, a cameo in the back. He wanted to match my pants that, I don't know, what's going on there. We staged that, obviously. actually, Allison Kuo, who's here. Yay. Yeah, Allison had a haircut. There's a few other people here who had haircuts. Yeah, that's actually how I met Allison. She was a frequent. You actually helped build the wall, didn't you?
Yeah, I got some people to come
up. You had people come help. That's
so much.
Yeah, it was like Allison's second home for 2 months. It was basically just a space. You came and got your haircut, you came and looked at the archive, and then every Saturday we had the salon, we had performances, and we basically asked different artists to come in who did work that didn't privilege sight. So art practices that were like spoken word or performance or sound, things that generated or were in conversation with other parts of other sensory relationships than the visual. So this is an invite. We made invites every week. You can't really see anything here, but there was a performance going on behind the wall, and that was by MPA, and then it was on the two monitors. There was a live feed to the two monitors while you got your haircut. There was another invite. And this is one where Sergei Tretyepin, who's a sound artist, would do sound massages. He used the bass nodes of speakers. And when they meet your skin, you feel the vibration of the sound that's coming through. It actually comes through as like a physical feeling. And then the thing that happens is your body becomes a speaker. So nobody hears it outside, but you hear the sound internally. This was a really, this is an extra special event, I think. And this is someone getting it while they got their hair cut. They're really indulging. Okay, I'm gonna skip over the poetry parade, but this is where we like read to some work in the permanent collection. That's all you need to know about that one. This is a shaving performance. These are the archival images. This is the video. The video is up right now, so you can go see that. I'm not gonna talk about it. This video is the one that's up at Marlborough Gallery, and it's basically I'm trying not to talk about it, but it's generative of these images that we found in one of the archives in San Francisco. There's a full body shave that was happening in a dungeon. And my partner and I recreated that using my hairy bottom half and we had an interest in like the sort of gender divide that occurs around hair in this piece and sort of what it meant for men to engage in body shaving, whereas women engaging in body shaving was like part of a cultural norm, actually. And then what my body does in relationship to that is whatever. So, anyways, you can go see the work. It's up right now. Okay. This work is called Touch Parade. It's a 5-channel video installation. This work started through a kind of rabbit hole, a YouTube rabbit hole, let's just say. Somebody sent me a YouTube fetish video, and this was like, I'm gonna say it was 2007 maybe. So YouTube was like 3 or 4 years old at this point, which I know seems like recent history, but it's crazy that, it's crazy to me partially because if I Google this stuff now, like the whole genre of fetish video is like this thing, and I feel a little complicated, let's just say, about all of this. So at that moment, it was, I think, a little bit more of a revelation to look at how, I guess, whatever social media, internet-based media was changing the way people sort of made contact with each other, communicated in various ways. Old news at this point. But so I was already in the middle of doing Community Action Center, so I was deep in the, like, what is sex question when I sort of started working on this work on my own. And I wanted to kind of do a piece that for me, it comes back to also this interest in kind of the sensory or the experiential or the tactile and how that exists or relates to our real bodies when it meets, bodies in the internet, I guess, where there's this kind of mediation, you know. I mean, film and video have a long history, obviously, in terms of pornographic images, et cetera, but there was something in the YouTube structure that was really about this really immediate exchange, and there was a lot of, like, people making videos for each other, you know, there's a real community and exchange that's happening in that space. One thing I started to notice is that some of the fetish videos would send you over to XTube where you had to say you were 18 or over, and some would remain in the sort of neutral, non-sexual zone of regular YouTube. So I became really interested in what qualifies something as explicit. Like, why does something that all of the original videos I was looking at were made to were made to be to basically to elicit a sexual or erotic response, right? So there's nothing really in their essence that's different from some other pornographic content, just that the individuals who are engaged in it is marginal, it's smaller, it's not read culturally as what qualifies as sex again, which is part of the discussion that was happening for me with Community Action Center. And so, and then there was also a part of this for me that was really interesting because it felt like or reminded me of like early performance art video, where there's just sort of experiments with the body. And I thought this was really interesting that this sort of exchange felt like it, because of certain factors, because it didn't have the markers of other forms of sexuality, it sort of entered this liminal space between art video and pornography, I guess, but not either and not both. You know, it's either and both, or sort of. So as I was, basically what happened is I started reenacting various videos. I watched a lot of them, and I was doing these very strict reenactments where I was really interested in the set of gestures and repeating the set of gestures and how a set of gestures might, you know, articulate some of the meaning. I don't know, I had this, you know, you start on a piece and you really have these, like, it's got to be about this thing. And something that I learned through doing it, doing this work, was that I actually had to really embody, performing or copying was disingenuous, just ingenuine at some point. And then also I found the more that I sort of engaged with these things, that I had my sort of own relationship to each video genre that I'd leaned from. And in that, then I also started to insert different things that were personal or particular to my own set of desires. So I'm gonna jump forward for a second, but for example, I have got really obsessed with like buying rubber gloves every time I went to the hardware store. And so I had this like insane collection in my studio of rubber gloves of like, I just like loved all the colors, and So I was like, so then I would be like, rubber glove fetish, you know, like I would find something that I was already having some kind of, you know, I was already indulging in my own sensory system, and I would then look it up. And so then I was like, okay, and I found glove videos, and so there would be gloves which were leather gloves or things that were prototypically maybe seen in the realm more generally known forms of pornography, you know, black leather, heels, like there's certain markers that we can associate with those things. And I was really interested in when those images moved outside of that. So it was like people working with the materials just around their house. And again, this kind of gleaning from your environment. And so this one is literally just the putting on of the layers and layers of gloves. This one is driving, and it's all about the pedal pumping. This one is crushing. I was really obsessed with eggs at that time. I kept trying to do things with eggs, I don't know. And then, so I just ended up crushing eggs in this one. And balloons, I kept trying to cast balloons in my studio, which is terrible. Like, you know, you're making bad art and then you're like, oh, that's where it goes. It goes in the video piece. So this is also just a lesson in like, you know, you're always making, and like the like things that don't fall into place, like being really open to like understanding when things find their place in your work is like, it's just, it's a good place to get to. And then this one is mud, wading in the mud, and that's me digging the pit, because I had to dig a pit for that one. Okay, I don't know why I put that in there. And the only other thing I want to say about this was very intentionally installed in terms of the scale of the monitors is specific. There's two larger monitors and two sort of slightly smaller, three that are in slightly smaller size. And they're all scaled a little bit. It's sort of one-to-one scale with the body. And then they're set at heights that relate to where the activity is taking place in relation to your own torso as you're approaching the work. And then they're set on these sort of pedestals in space. It was really important to me that you weren't going to come in and just like look at images of this thing. I actually wanted people to have a sensory relationship to the work. And so the other thing that's happening is the sound in this is all this sort of just live sound that's picked up from doing all these activities. And so you just hear this kind of rustling, crunching. There's like a kind of cacophony of those sounds in the room when you come into it. And then it's also a space that you're supposed to be able to walk through. So you can take it in as a whole image, or you can have these kind of more personal experiences and have, I was really interested in how one might relate their own body to the experience instead of this kind of, I think there's a whole thing with the fetish, fascination with fetish culture, of kind of objectifying it in terms of it being like somehow other from your own experience. And I think that most people can relate to like, I don't know, picking up a piece of dough and just like kneading it, you know. Like we all have these kind of like material desires, and I wanted to bring the kind of othering that occurs in that space back into the sort of how we experience things in our own body, sort of more on a one-to-one. Also, because I think the frame and the video often are about constructing those kind of objectified spaces. So is it possible to make video and have a relationship to it that's not that? You know, this is kind of some of the questions there. Okay, really, here we go. Smeary spot, you guys. This is the end. So very briefly, I'm working on a science fiction thing. I really love genre busting, as I'll call it, or just like kind of, that's kind of the way I came to the porn. It was like, okay, what happens if you take porn and then you just like crack it open? So I'm interested in what happens if you take science fiction and you crack it open? And some of my interests in coming to science fiction have to do with just the long history of science fiction novels in particular, but also in films, to have a kind of underlying political narrative, but told through the fantastical space. So, the fictional. And so I'm really interested in that kind of play between how we could express political issues in that way. But that work is a whole longer story, and it's something that the first version of it isn't going to be ready until fall of 2015, and I had all of this stuff in here about it, and I was like, oh my god, we'll be here all night if I try and explain this thing that's not done. So what I am going to show you is something I did this summer while I was on a residency. Because I'm kind of always, a lot of the work I'm doing right now is kind of towards this science fiction. But I don't always know what the science fiction is supposed to be. I have a lot of ideas about it. So this was, I went out to Oakland on a residency, and I thought, okay, well, I'm in a place where I don't really know that many people. I'd like to meet people here, and I also, so there was some excuse in making this work around that, and that was, I thought, okay, well, what if I do screen tests? Now, that doesn't mean, I'm not even sure if I really want any dialogue in this science fiction, but I did like the idea of, well, maybe just what is a screen test and what could one make around that premise of the screen test. And that gives me excuse to invite people in and like, you know, have them read something. And
make something. So what I did was, I'm going to scoot forward, is I made a script, which was basically cutting and pasting together about, I don't know, what is it, 6, 8 different texts. Things that I all grabbed off the bookshelf right before I went to Oakland, and I was like, these are all things I'm thinking about for the, you know, I might get some reading done, like, you know, here's my stack to go on residency with. And so, and things that were, some of it very directly related to science fiction, some of it related to sort of larger political thoughts. So it's The Screwball Asses by Guy Hokunquim. I'm always mispronounced that. I hope I got that right. The Communist Manifesto, a classic. We Who Are About To by Joanna Russ, which is a science fiction novel from the 70s. It's like feminist science fiction novel from the 70s, kind of obscure. Affinities Between Reproduction and Death, from Eroticism, Death, and Sensuality by Bataille. An excerpt from The Ethics of Ambiguity from Simone de Beauvoir. Revolt, She Said by Julia Kristeva, and then another text, The New Misandry, by Joanna Russ, which is like misogyny, but the opposite. Misandry, misogyny. Okay. So basically, I had this pile. I cut and paste. I wanted to see if I could get it to read as one kind of, let's say, poetic manifesto. Could I take all these texts and make it seem seamless in some way as actually a script for this fictitious whatever it is that's basically just a culmination of ideas I care about that are things that I'm thinking about in relation to this other project. So there's some things you can, well, you can kind of read how it's going from Screwball Asses to like to The Communist Manifesto, like in that first section. And I have become an appendage of the machine. And that kind of language that's coming from Marx seems to relate to the way the body is being talked about in the previous text. And then what I've done is I've redacted things where it felt like, one thing I started to realize when I had people read these is like a lot of these are you know, kind of heavy theory texts. Not all of them, but a lot of them. And so they're not really so eloquent to read out loud as if they're a script or something that should be done with any kind of affect. So sometimes I just removed things to make the text read better. And then sometimes the other main thing I did was I changed all of the, anytime it was pronoun specific, which tended to be the he, because he is always everybody. Right? In these kind of texts. So I either made them first person possessive, as in I, or I made them collective in terms of like they. So they were sort of minor shifts in the text to make this script. And the other thing, so I went out and I shot. So the other thing is that the smeary spot comes from the very last line in the script, which you'll hear because I'm going to play the end of it for you. And a smeary spot refers to the sun in this text or in the excerpt that it comes from. And so I went out and I actually just like. I went out to the waterfront and on the bay and shot the sunset because if you haven't noticed, I also really like romantic tropes. So there's something about the sort of the sunset clearly has its own baggage, but I think that I was also interested in that this was a horizon or a landscape that was all, or a waterscape. And so that it was also a site that was sort of unfixed and constantly shifting. It's like not land in that way, but it evokes the kind of, it's in the language of landscape, obviously, because that's what it is. Yes. And then also thinking about, there's not that much. I could say a lot about the sun, but I think I'm going to just let it go. So this, the film starts with this sort of sunset, and it gets darker through the progression of the film. And I have to say what I have here is for me a very much a first edit. And it's, so I don't know. I have a lot of questions about deciding to inset the video, and there's some things happening in here, but you can just take it as a sketch that I'm working on. And the other thing that I was really thinking about as people were going to do these readings is kind of how political speech works, in the sense that I started thinking about how politics is often more about affect than content. And then I thought about when people fail to have affect, when they're, you know, when you're reading a script and you're not actually a professional, and you don't, you do or you do not have the skills to, like, I was interested in people like reading it well and not reading it well, and that I was going to seam together all of the readings to make up the whole text. So it would take a group of people to read this thing, and it would also be about screen tests not being about an individual who's doing the best job at reading, but it would be screen tests as in a format for accumulating the whole sort of narrative. Now this part is actually read quite well, but you'll see. Okay, so I'm just gonna play this. I'm gonna play this. That's what we're gonna do.
I will be granted these fantasies and the utopia that goes with them. The fact remains that homosexuality can only escape heterosexuality by becoming a relation of weakness, of non-rivalry or non-property.
That is, by inverting paranoia into schizophrenia. If reserve and human respect remains whole, as in transfixed suffering and dignified lovers, if the purity of sentiments absorbs the shadows, then the homosexual is but half a rebel.
Then the homosexual is but half a rebel. Rigged with a mythical third sex, I continue to drone out virility, a test of conquests. And an aching heart. Imagine a flat world, a piece of paper, say with two spots, but very far apart. If you were a two-dimensional triangle, how would you get from one spot to the other? Walk? No, too far. But fold the paper through the third dimension, hours. So that the spots match exactly.
If you were a triangle, you couldn't see or feel this, of course.
And you are in the proper place. I do this in the fourth, don't ask me how. Only you must be very, very
unfold space-time. Not to slosh the paper around or let it slide. Then you end up not on the spot you wanted, but who knows where. Maybe entirely out of our galaxy.
Far, far from home.
The light of our dying may not reach you for 1,000,000,000 years. That ordinary sun up there, a little hazy now at noon, is a smeary spot.
So the only thing I'll say about that is I had performers. There were three. I was actually living in the gallery that I was going to do a show in that was the residency. It was all on one site. So I had people either go to three sites in the space, either the kitchen, the bedroom, or the bathroom to do the readings. And then we each person kind of came up. We all came up with like a remedial task to do while they did their reading. That's the other premise. And that's it. I think I'm going to end there. That's a no. I wasn't really thinking of monumentalizing them. I think there was for me an interest in like merging the kind of materia. There's like kind of the material of their making, although it's not the material of their making. I guess I was thinking about what the shirt is symbolically and what it is in relation to the material. It, you know, I also chose aluminum specifically because it's a new metal. It's actually a man-made metal. And it's, you know, it's made to be more, to be more lightweight and various things. It's, you know, technologically devised type of metal. So it's not like a traditional foundry metal like bronze and iron and stuff like that. It comes more directly from the earth. And so there was also something for me, they feel a little bit designed in that way because aluminum has that quality to it. And I was interested in that, like a technological advancement, and then its relationship to this sort of different forms of labor. If we're moving away from blue collar and industrial labor and into kind of, again, like effective labor and other immaterial labors. And that's a result of certain technological advancements. It's an amalgamation of like a material that's somewhat symbolic of that transition, but that's also rooted in the sort of physical space of the foundry, and then what that shirt does in that space, which is very simply like protect, you know, it's like you have to be fully, I don't know. I don't know if that was a good explanation, but did that satisfy that? Yeah, maybe a little bit, okay. For me, it's like I'm always looking for, I need to be working in a lot of different ways. I have fantasies that I would be like a formalist sculptor some days, and then that just doesn't totally hold water for me, you know? So I'll do some things that are really invested in some kind of formal relationship to things. And a lot of the artwork at its basis has a lot of, even when it's, I think even Community Action Center or something like that, it's like, you know, it's very visually rich and it's not didactic or literal in any way. You know, it's an experience.
And I work with art because I really think that's the best way to communicate with people, honestly. Like, I love entering people's sensory sphere as a way to, like, be engaged. And I like making art because I like the public interface that it offers, you know? I like teaching for that reason. I do even more like direct action political work for other reasons, because there are things that I feel like, I don't think art is like inherently like gonna change the world. I don't believe in like political art so that equals like change inherently. Although I do think it expands people's minds potentially to, I like to use it and look at it as ways to do that. Maybe that's a good excuse to do that, which I'm not gonna get into here, because Lise, our core organizer for WAGE, is gonna come speak to some of you guys. And if anyone's really interested in what WAGE is, you can go to that lecture. You can also go to this website, wageforwork.com. It's so intense and so extensive at this point, like the number of things we have up here. But this is for a project where I'm like, okay, is this my art practice? No. I mean, we make some videos and we do, sometimes we have fun with it. But, you know, we've always really, like, people would, when we first started WAGE, Working Artists in the Greater Economy, people used to be like, oh, you're an art collective, can you be in a show? And we're like, no, we're advocating for artists to get paid, you know, when they work with a museum, not, you know, we don't, that's what we make. You know what I mean? And it's actually really important that that for us was not going to get co-opted as like, oh, this is a cool, you know, how there's this way where political art gets like taken in by the institution and then they're like, oh, we're a cool institution because we did something political. And it was really important for us that that didn't kind of get co-opted by that kind of relationship. And so like one of the times we got asked to be in a show, we said, well, we can't be in a show, but we can certify your show, which is this proposal we came up with years ago and literally just manifested it like 4 days ago. Certification, October 6th, look at that. Look how recent it is. and so the first experiment with certification was at the New Museum. They asked us to be in this show called Free, ironically enough. And we said, well, we're not going to be in your show, but we'll certify your show if you'll prove to us that you've paid all the artists in the exhibition. And so that's, you know what I mean? So that was a very long answer to like politics and art, but I think, I get angry about things and I feel really agitated in the world, and it's hard for me to just like make things that look nice. I love to make things that look nice, but I want them to like, they need to mean something for me, even if it's like nobody else gets it. Like, I need to have that grounding in it. So, and then there's ways that that manifests that are really literal, and then there's ways that are more abstract. The work often reflects in various ways, I think, and not just like through some kind of like queer politics angle, but even like formal decisions, like thinking about the water, as a moving landscape and as a kind of what it means when something is unfixed or undetermined or not being able to be sort of held in a specific way. And, you know, I am me and I make my art. So I sit here in this body going, you know, I go by she ostensibly because I don't want to go by he, but I don't care, you know? Like, it's just, I just don't, gender's just like, I don't get it actually. Is more where I stand, like it doesn't make any sense to me. And I see it as something that marks my own body and marks bodies of the world in really specific ways. And of course, because some people perceive me as a man at times, but I carry, you know, certainly the biology of being a woman with me into the world, and I have been more feminine at points in my life. I feel deeply aligned with certain, you know, what the experience of being a woman in the world is. I also see that as an extension of like class and race issues in terms of, I mean, this is sort of feminism 101, but you know, it's like questioning, you know, feminism at its core is questioning power, right? Like, it's the politics of questioning power, really. Like, gender politics plays into that, but so do a lot of other things. And it's also where people are like, can men be feminists? You know, it's like, yeah, of course, you know, this is not, it doesn't belong to a particular, you know, so I think I've digressed, and I'm not exactly answering your question, but I think, I guess I'm just saying, like, I don't know if you're asking me something that's a little bit outside of me, which is like, I'm always gonna make from the place of a body that's liminal, feels that way in the world. And so those things get articulated in various forms in my work. I guess that's the simplest answer. Yeah, you're not the first one, it's cool. And it's intentional, you know. It's important to me that people can't figure it out. Yeah, I'm totally cool with it. It's just the New York Public Library.
Oh, that's it.
Yeah, it's in Midtown. It's the one in Midtown Manhattan. It's on like the third or fourth floor, and it's the picture, I think it's called the Picture Library, Picture Archive. If you go to the desk, front desk, they'll send you the right spot. Yeah.
The one with the
lions. The lions? Yeah, the ones with the lions out front. The big, oh yeah, not the lions one, no. It's not the one with the big stairs, it's the one across the street that's in the newer building, yeah. I mean, this is interesting because like I said, it's a sketch for me right now. And so I'm showing you something in a vulnerable state where, you know, I'm like, I feel like I tipped the like affect meter a little bit too far, you know? And so I'm probably gonna pull that back a little bit because I think the raw readings might be better. But I was partially doing it because I was like, I'm gonna get into the like sci-fi zone and you're gonna like, woo, feel this thing. Yeah, and so I was definitely trying to cultivate like this thing that was like kind of a clunky narrative. I mean, the parts you saw were actually read quite smoothly, but there's other parts where it's like the paper's in the way and you're like, you know, it's more clear that this is a kind of recitation and sort of the reading is not always successful in that sort of part of it. And I guess I was kind of trying to push that, like, okay, what happens when you have sort of bad performance and then the manipulation, the possibilities of manipulation within cinema is a whole other kind of guide. And so I want to play with that edge, and I haven't quite found that edge yet.
I don't know.
I will ultimately, because I think this is going to actually end up in the science fiction larger work. But because of time, this was just done in like a 3-week, I actually did the whole thing in a week, but it was over a 3-week period that I was on a residency. So, you know, I used some clips from Pauline Oliveras and this other like kind of new age band called Tangerine Dream, classic synth, early synth music. So yeah, I cut my own soundtrack with other people's music, but I usually prefer to work with when I do a sort of grander cinematic work, I wanna collaborate with people on that part. Should we go drink? Get out of this hot room.